thank you very much, Mike, for your wonderful introduction. Something to live up to. I asked Mike about this piano before I came here, and he told me that it's actually his. He's just purchased it, and after this is over, it'll go to his house in the Boston area. And I asked him, what do you want me to do? And he said, I want you to make love to it. So I've been racking my brains to find out, maybe figure out how to do this without getting arrested. So I'll do my best. I wanted to tell you about a particularly wonderful piece of music that I discovered a few years ago. I'm a classical pianist, but I have developed a reputation for exploring the beyond the boundaries of the so-called accepted repertoire, you know, the things that one hears all the time. And some years ago, a friend of mine alerted me to the existence of a wonderful recording. Now, these are arrangements, six of them, of French chansons by a wonderful singer-songwriter named Charles Trenet, who is not very well known around here in the North America, but he is just as famous as, let's say, Maurice Chevalier in France. The only reason you would know him is for this. So that's him. But he wrote tons of other wonderful songs, and this is an arrangement of a song called En Avril à Paris, which translates as April in Paris, although this is not the song that we know as April in Paris. It's a totally different one. I apologize, by the way, to those few who heard this last night. I just love to play this piece, you know, so I'll introduce it again, and it's really worth hearing for all of you. I mean, the recording in question through which I was introduced to this piece is very rare indeed. It appeared as a 45 RPM sometime in the 50s, and it was simply called Mr. Nobody Plays Trenet. For many years, we didn't know who the pianist was. And it turns out that in recent years, he was revealed as one of the great pianists of the 20th century, Alexis Weissenberg, who is Bulgarian-born, but French, a naturalized French citizen. And he had a very strong compositional streak. But everything that he wrote, or at least everything that I'm aware of personally, is in the popular vein. He actually wrote a musical, which unfortunately flopped in both of its productions. It was produced in French at first, and then translated in German, and that flopped as well. Although there's some wonderful music in it, but he always had this wonderful sort of popular streak. And I like to, myself, like a few of my colleagues, play some more popular music or less classical, you say. So I thought this was particularly wonderful. When I heard this recording the first time, my jaw dropped. And the only problem was that Weissenberg never wrote down the music. So I set out to write it out myself, because I had to. It's the only way I could play. I couldn't quite pick it up by ear, because it's really quite complex. Now, in order to do this, you have to be a composer, I think, because you have to be able to notate these things satisfactorily. But you also have to be a pianist, because when there's mistakes in the recording, you have to know what the real note is, and sometimes you can only figure it out by sort of second guessing what the pianist was trying to do and didn't. And that's all well and good, but you also need, in this case, slowing down software, because even if you have the most wonderful ear in the world, you just won't catch all of the intricacies. So, and this was the first time that I got acquainted with slowing down software. I think it's a marvelous instrument, and it allowed me to hear an unbelievable amount of detail. So this is how I was able to do what you're about to hear. Thank you. It might be surprising to many of you that there is a sizable body of literature written for the piano just for the left hand. It might seem like a weird idea at first to just play with one hand, but there are a few reasons, above and beyond perhaps. Well, I'd fleetingly thought of appearing here and going. But you've seen that already. Writing for the left hand alone is actually a long and noble tradition. There are apparently, I am told, something like 400 composers, some of them, of course, very minor, but who actually have written for the left hand alone. You might ask, why not for the right hand alone? The answer is simply that the left hand, the configuration of the left hand is much better suited to carry out melody and accompaniment at the same time successfully. With the right hand, it's possible, but it's a lot more difficult. So this accounts for the fact that there are very, very few pieces written for the right hand alone. It also helps the considerable, unfortunately, number of pianists who have injured their right hands, and there are even some at this day and age. One of the most remarkable events, I think, perhaps the most remarkable event as far as the subject of literature for the left hand, is the philanthropic activities of Paul Wittgenstein, who was a pianist who lost his right arm during the First World War. He was the brother of Ludwig Wittgenstein, and he commissioned a great number of composers to write concerti for left hand and orchestra, the most famous one being, of course, written by Maurice Ravel, but there's many other composers like Prokofiev, Hindemith, Benjamin Britten, and quite a few who were also asked, and they all produced the goods. I wanted to be part of this tradition in whatever way I could, and I set out to arrange a song by Tchaikovsky, which is not very well known in this country, unfortunately, because the poem that is sung is in Russian, so you don't hear too many people here essaying Russian songs, but in Russia this song is extremely well known, and so is the poem. It is, it's called Lullaby, and I think I'll let the music speak for itself, because it's, I hope it'll do that. so much. Of course, I neglected to tell you in my nervousness that the real reason for writing for the left hand is to really try to make one hand sound like two. And that's what I tried to do here. It was someone who Michael mentioned actually a little earlier on, Leopold Godowsky, who said once that if it is possible to entrust to one hand the material that can be played by two, you know, imagine the possibilities for composers were this extended to both hands, and to make them sound like four. So this represents great possibilities for composers. I want to finish with one of the most remarkable of all of the preludes by Claude Debussy, the master of the pictorial and the sensual in music. This is a prelude called Fireworks. He even gives you a suggestion as to what day of the year this is in the tail end of the piece. Of course, you know, France, fireworks, no brainer.